With the rifle in one hand and good book in the other.
Yeah.
That if I should die at the muzzle of the rifle, die on water or on land, I may know that you, blessed Jesus Almighty, are with me. And I have no fear. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, my Lord, 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 Lord. Oh, my Lord, 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 Lord.
Lord, we stand before you this evening to say thank you.
Thank you.
We thank you, Father, for your grace and your many blessings.
Yes.
Now, I run off and left all my youngins and my kinfolk in bondage. So I'm standing here this evening, Heavenly Father, to ask your blessings on all of us.
Amen.
So that if tomorrow is our great getting up morning,
amen.
If tomorrow we have to meet the judgment day, Heavenly Father, we want you to let our folks know that we died facing the enemy. We want them to know that we went down standing up.
Yes, Lord.
Amongst those that are fighting against our oppression. We want them to know, Heavenly Father, that we died for freedom.
Amen.
We ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Say what you think. Just say what you feel.
Come on,
let it out.
Well, I ain't much about no friend now.
Well, all right. All right.
I never had no family. Killed off my mama. You feel funny, don't you?
Come on,
man. You're doing fine. Well, I just... Y'all's the only family I got.
Well,
yeah,
that's all right.
And I love the 54.
Right. All right.
Ain't much a matter what happens tomorrow, but we men ain't.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Oh, my Lord.
meditations of my heart be made acceptable in thy sight, O God. You are our strength and our Redeemer. Bless us now, God, in this preaching moment, that your word will go forth, never to come back void, but accomplish the purpose for which it is sent. In the name of Jesus we pray. And God, we give you thanks. Let us say together, amen. Amen. Stand with me all over the building and turn with me to the book of Isaiah, the 58th chapter. And I want to read for your hearing verses 1 through 12. Book of Isaiah. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the house of Jacob their sins. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I have chosen, only a day for a man to humble himself? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying on sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, and set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe him and not to turn away from your own flesh and blood, then your light will break forth like the dawn and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here am I. If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with the pointing finger and malicious talk, and if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness, and your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land, and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will rise up the age-old foundation and will be called repairer of broken walls, restorer of streets with dwellings. The scripture as it is written, it is always our prayer. God bless us in the reading and the hearing of his most Holy Word. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord and each other. And as you take your seat, take your neighbor by the hand and ask them, neighbor, are you living big or small? I want to use as a subject living bigger. Living bigger. And I'm so glad that it is African American History Month or Black History Month. Depending on how old you are, it may still be to you Negro History Month. It has been all of those things. And I'm so glad because Black History Month, like Women's History Month, are months that the nation has set aside in its majority opinion to fill in gaps in the national narrative where certain people groups and their contributions to the nation historically have been omitted from history books, as if we were not there, as if white men were the only ones who contributed to the building of this nation. It's good, it's bad, it's ugly. But in fact, we have been there from the beginning. When the Mayflower landed in 1620, it was a year behind when the British Dutch man of war landed down in the Carolinas and unloaded 19 Africans and began what John Hope Franklin called a peculiar institution for 244 years, work without compensation, and another 100 years of segregation after that. It's good that we saw this weekend how badly we need it, not only to most African Americans. If we were to break out with Lift Every Voice and Sing without the words on the screen, most of us couldn't even mumble through the first verse. That's a shame, because when you go to South Africa, everybody knows No Sisi Kelele Africa, because it is the song, a narrative of who they are as a people. When you forget your own song and forget your own story. But we find that we're not the only people who need some help in Black history. Apparently, our current president and his White House press secretary still think Frederick Douglass is still alive. And the more we listen to him and give him recognition, he's going to be appreciated. For the record, Frederick Douglass was born 1818 and died 1895 of a sudden heart attack at 77 years of age. You can Google it on the way home. We showed you the scene from the 1989 movie Glory, which has everything to do with the Civil War and the Massachusetts 54th Regiment of Colored Soldiers that stormed one of the great forts at the start of the Civil War, that while most of the men in the battle died, their valor reached Lincoln, who made an executive decision, signed an executive order to allow colored troops to join the fight and not just be contraband for the Union Army, not just pull logs and do manual labor, which was just another form of slavery. And it was the introduction of the colored troops in the battle that tipped the balance of the war in the favor of the Union and made the demise of slavery an inevitability. And you see, when you see the characters in the movie, Private Tripp, played by Denzel Washington, and he was a trip, you see the one gentleman who, Private Ply, who started off talking about if I should die on land or die on water. He said, we're going to die like men. And Morgan Freeman, who prayed, the grave digger, was digging the graves for the white soldiers that fell on both sides of the Mason-Dixon line till he joined the fight. And then even Colonel Robert, who was the privileged free black man from up north, in Boston, when Boston still had integrity long before Belichick and Brady got there. I can say that I was born in Boston. Can anything good come out of Boston? Come and see. And when you look at the clip, one of the things you notice is that they all prayed with their eyes open. Jesus once said, watch and pray. There are times in life, even when you pray, you need to keep watching. I think we're living in days and times today, while we need to pray, we need to watch and pray. This ain't no time to close your eyes. There's too much stuff going on. But Joe, I believe that you could take that moment in African American history, which is really a slice out of the American history, and it was a time in which all of the characters in that movie could claim what the wisdom of what Martin King once said. He says, a man has not found anything, a man or woman for that matter, has not found anything in his life worth dying for, they're not fit to live. And the battle to which they lost their lives, the battle for freedom, The battle against slavery in particular, but all forms of discrimination, all crimes against the human spirit, in the words of Reinhold Niebuhr, man's inhumanity to man, people's inhumanity to people, to make this a more perfect union, or in Martin King's words, in search of beloved community, or as Jesus called it, the kingdom of God. I think their fitness showed, and that's what where the word glory comes from, that the glory is revealed. We experience the glory when we give our lives over to something bigger than our selfish preoccupations. So many people come and go in this life and they never live for anything other than the pursuit of a roof over their own head, clothes on their own back, food for their own belly, and maybe the same for their loved ones. They never move beyond the small, insular inner circle of self-preservation for themselves and their loved ones. And while that is important because we have to survive before we can do anything in life, there are times in life, and certainly that colossal contest between North and South for the soul of a nation that could not live, in the language of Lincoln, half slave and half free. It was a time when it called people to make a decision. There are times in the life of a nation, of a society, sometimes in the life of a church, sometimes in the life of a family, when you cannot not choose. And people have to make a choice between whether or not they're going to live big or live small. And these little men, these made-up characters in a very real historical circumstance, they're fictional characters in a very real historical circumstance. The only real character in the movie was Robert Gould Shaw, who was the colonel in charge of the 54th of Massachusetts. The others were made-up characters, fictional characters in a historical event and time, who certainly people like Major Robert, who was a free black man up north, a privileged individual among an underprivileged people. You know, among any underprivileged people, they're still privileged individuals who could sit on the sideline. But as the conductor of the Underground Railroad told Harriet Tubman when she escaped from the slave state of Maryland to the free state of Pennsylvania and then asked to go back across the Mason-Dixon line to free her family and friends who was still in the throes of slavery. They said, "Miss Tubman, you don't understand. Once you cross that Mason-Dixon line, you're a slave again." And her retort was, "If God called me, God will protect me." She chose to live big and not live small. And each one of us as an individual in life, over and over and over again, life presents challenging moments. We have to choose to live. We're going to live big or live small. In the 1980s, this term came living large. And now you remember the 1980s and the selfish, narcissistic values of the 1980s when you had epitomized by Wall Street, where the gentleman said, played by Michael Douglas, says, "Greed is good," against the backdrop of Reaganism in the beginning of trickle-down voodoo economics that some people still want to practice today, and at a time when greed seemed good and living large meant living materially wasteful. It meant large house, large car, bigger is better, more is merrier, it's my prerogative. All those selfish, narcissistic, insular values. I get mine, you get yours, propped up even by a kind of prosperity theology where the churches got in spiritualized greed so that the selfish, insidious pursuit of material things and personhood on the basis of what you own owns you, became seen as a badge of favor with God. We called the acquisition of things favor by that mentality. If you go to the scripture, then Pharaoh was the object of God's favor, and Caesar was the object of God's favor, and people begin to choose to what they called living large was really living small, because they live life in pursuit of things, creature comforts, self-aggrandizement, self-promotion, and became less and less concerned with their neighbor. Never looking out the window pane, always looking in the mirror to see what they needed next. Everybody has to ask themselves, do I live my life looking in the mirror to see what I need next? Or do I look out the window pane to see what's going on? These little nobodies, born with the wrong color skin in a nation where the darker, the worse, they chose to live big and to die with glory. Die with glory. Because they found out what it was like to live big, no matter how small and meager the origins you come from. And that's the tension in the text here in the 58th chapter of the book of Isaiah, where there's an indictment here because the people of God, the nation that is uniquely called into covenant with God, constrained to the will of God in covenant, the descendants of Jacob, that they are 7 centuries before Christ, 8th century BC, or as they say today, BCE, before the current era, because it offends some people to say before Christ. But when they say BCE, before the current era, that means BC. And that the children of God were, in God's estimation, living small. They were living small. And the writer, Isaiah, I want to keep it simple, though. Isaiah says, he says 3 things here about the, in his oracle of the people of God. Now, the first thing we have to, I want you to know, put it in historical context. The book of Isaiah is really the testimony of 3 different writers. You need to know that to keep the text in the context. There is the historical figure of Isaiah, the 8th century BC prophet, the shepherd from Tishbite, who he writes chapters 1 through 47. Included in there are those majestic words that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up wings like eagles. They'll run and not grow weary. They'll walk and not faint. But chapters 48 through 55 were written by what we call Deutero-Isaiah. Deutero second, like in the book of Deuteronomy, the second law. Deutero-Isaiah was another figure. The original Isaiah wrote in this 8th century BC as Judah was in decline. The nation was going on a slow descent because it had lost its way. And the prophets came one after another warning them to get back to true devotion to God. Stop living so small. And he defines what living small is. But they didn't heed the prophets, so they fell into exile. The Babylonians were Nebuchadnezzar, and they rode their iron chariots and trashed the gates of Jerusalem, took the sacred vessels and bowls from the temple and despoiled them with their wine and their meat and dragged their sons and daughters butt naked over the desert sands, over by the rivers of Babylon, where they could only weep and remember Zion. All of that happened in 3 different deportations, 622, 605, and 587 BC. Deutero-Isaiah writes during the time of the exile, when they lived in their shame, when they had not heeded God's warning and fell into the judgment of God by being taken exile. And part of what he says is, as they look forward, you messed up in the past, but as you look forward, God's going to build a highway through the holiness. A highway in the desert. He's going to let you go back someday. And then there's what we call third Isaiah. Third Isaiah writes during the time of the resettlement, after Zerubbabel has rebuilt the temple and Nehemiah has helped rebuild the wall and Ezra has come along and trying to reestablish covenant law in the hearts of the people. Treto Isaiah is one of those voices along with Ezra that comes during the time of the rebuilding. In the 5th century BC, we have 6th and 5th century BC, 2 generations after resettling the land, this unknown pseudonymous Asiatic writer, it's not the first Isaiah, who was 700 years before the birth of Christ. It is 2 to 3 generations later, after the exile, and when they have returned to the land to rebuild, they're trying to make Israel great again. And then, like now, some of the people come around with the language of making under the guise of making Israel great again. They're really living small. In verses 1 and 2, you see that there is there's a statement here that they give the appearance of being devoted to God. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion. How are we rebelling against God? We go to worship. We engage in ritual acts of contrition. We're in the house of God. For day after day, they seek me out. They seem. You see that word there? They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commandments of its God. They ask me for just decisions. They seem eager for God to come near them. But here is the thing. The children of Israel literally are coming and they're engaging in ritual acts of contrition. They're fasting. They're maintaining the feast calendar and all of the decorums of the cult life of Israel. But here's where they begin to expose their spiritual unfitness. It says in verse 3, they raise the question, why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed it? In other words, the people of God are coming to God. They're engaging in all of the churchy stuff, or for them, temple stuff, what we would call the churchy stuff. And yet they come with a complaint on their lips. They come not with praise on their mouth, but a complaint in the lip. They're saying, Lord, we're doing all this stuff, this temple stuff. You know, church stuff, greeters and parking lot people and ushers and deacons and, you know, and Awana and classroom teaching, connections. They were doing all this churchy stuff. And yet, Lord, you ain't doing your job. Because we asking you for some stuff and you ain't giving. You ain't giving us the bennies enough. We've been asking you for some stuff and you ain't been giving us our stuff. We've been fasting. And we thought it was a one-to-one. We thought it was like hitting the right number. We thought it was like a genie lamp. You rub it just right, and all the stuff is supposed to come out. And so, Lord, we've fasted, and you haven't seen it. We've humbled ourselves, and you haven't noticed it because we haven't gotten our stuff. So they complain to God. They've come to church to indict God for God not being effective and efficient enough in his godness. And beginning second half of verse 3, God begins God's reply. Yet on the day of fasting, you do as you please. It starts with you exploit all your workers. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife. You are literally fasting and fighting, striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. And here's what was going on, Sam. What they were doing is they were literally coming to temple on Saturday, which was the Sabbath that they recognized. Our Sabbath is Sunday, the Christian Sabbath, because the Lord rose on Sunday morning. That's the Lord's Day in the Christian tradition. And I've had some people who are Seventh-day Adventists said, you know, the Sabbath is Saturday. Why y'all worship on Sunday? I said, because I'm not Jewish. I'm Christian. And he got up on Sunday morning. That's what we celebrate every time we come together is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jewish people get together and they remember the covenant in Genesis. We don't come together to talk about covenants in Genesis. We come together to talk about covenants via Calvary. So tell that to your Seventh-day Adventist friends. Get out of Genesis and get over into the New Testament. But that's a whole nother sermon. They were coming together, and when they came, they were coming literally processing court cases on the one day when all their clans were gathered together for the religious assembly. So when they came on Saturday for temple, that was when all hands were on deck. And when service was over or prior to, they were holding court over disputes they had with one another. So under the pretense of going to worship, they were really mobilizing so that they could process legal complaints with one another on the Lord's Day, complaints that were about their economic interests, their land conflicts, who shot John, and under the guise of ritual purity, while they're engaging in ritualistic acts of contrition and fasting, they really came to fight and pursue private agendas and were manipulating and abusing religious rituals, symbolism of even the religious day of the Lord in pursuit of their own private agendas. And they even had the nerve to complain that God wasn't being God enough where their self-interests were concerned. And God responds through the prophet Isaiah and lets them know that all of the ritual in the world, all of the smoking mirrors in the world, all the singing in the world, all the preaching in the world, all the praying in the temple in the world, all the payment of tithes and offering in the world will not hide from God that sometimes we do the right thing for the wrong reason. Sometimes we even touch spiritual things well, for the wrong reason. We got a hidden motives, and they may be hidden from man, but they are never hidden from God. God knows why we're here. God knows the undertaker who's here, not looking for God, just looking for bodies. God knows the physicians that are here looking for more patients. God knows the real estate people who join connections just to get connected to send out the promotion for their business. God knows the person who's in the choir who don't connect with the very words they're singing. They just want a mic so somebody can hear them run scale. God knows the people come to church and join a committee to get a title and some power because they don't have no power out there, so they want to be the HNIC up in here. God knows all the hidden reasons why we come here. It ain't got nary nothing to do with God. But taking advantage of the day that today you got a crowd. God knows all the sisters who are here praying for a BMW, a black man working at AA. Or a white man working or an Asian, it's just somebody with a job. And some credit. And you join the greeters so you can greet them. You join the ushers so that you could see them. You join the coffee bar so that you can meet them. Come on, somebody. You just on the seek. You on the prowl. You've gone from being streetwise to being churchwise. He preaching now. God knows. For all this pomp and circumstance, he says, you're living small. And he says, what is the fast that I want from you? You've given God what you wanted to give God, but you haven't given God what God wanted from you. Sometimes we offer God strange fire on the altar. We offer an offering that God can't even recognize. What is that mess? You dump the house, and God is saying, what is that mess? You killed it. God is saying, what is that mess? You came looking all reverent and holy. God is saying, that's a stench in my nostril. You smell foul. What is it that the Lord wants? And he says, is this the kind of fast I have chosen? Only a day? Humble submission? You're so holy on Sunday. It is only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying on sackcloth and ashes. That's all the ritual stuff. Is that what you call a fast? A day that's acceptable to the Lord? I used to hear people saying, don't cuss in church. As if God can't hear what you say in the parking lot. And I used to wonder, Clarence, you know, just tell me where God ain't listening because I got some stuff I need to say. There's a corner I cuss in. I need to find it because folk are bothering me. I know folk who used to go in the church bathroom and start cussing because they figured I didn't say it in the sanctuary. Is this what God wants from us? He says, is this the kind of fasting I have chosen to loose the chains of injustice? That matters after the benediction. To untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter when you see the naked to clothe him, and not to turn them away from your own flesh and blood, your own flesh and blood, then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear, and then your righteousness will go before you. You thought righteousness was wrapped up in ritual, but I've connected it to what you do for the least, and the glory of the Lord will be your real guard. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and I will say, here I am. You thought you were glorifying the Lord with that finely worked out song in rehearsal, and how well organized you served the Lord's Supper, and the fact that you didn't let nobody walk down the center aisle once service started to distract the preacher. You thought you glorified God in all of that. And he said that means nothing to God if in reality we're living small. Living for our own selfish pursuits, that even selfish motivations are the reason why we're even here on Sunday morning. And you know, sometimes we live small at a time when God is calling us to live big. They were supposed to be rebuilding Israel, but their smallness was getting in the way. The smallness kept them divided. The smallness kept conflict going. The smallness kept them majoring in minor things. Smallness, petty pursuits, gum up the works, fragment people. And sometimes nations are live small at times when they're called to be big. What a message. The central message that the inauguration message sent to the world on January the 20th, 2017, said, America first. Buy American, sell American. You know, if the only thing we buy is American stuff, then people won't buy our stuff. And if people don't buy our stuff, then we don't need stuff to make. That means we lose jobs, because trade is about you buy my stuff, I buy your stuff. But if we become protectionists and start trade wars, we'll cost more jobs than we think we're saving. When you say America first, it means no more NATO. We're only concerned about ourselves. We're going to abandon agreements to work together for stability, protection, security, and prosperity. America first, we're not worried about nobody else. Even nations like Iraq that have people on the ground fighting for our vaunted freedoms, fighting against Al-Qaeda alongside us, and now you're going to block their people from coming in this country. America first, it says, us, I, me, and my. We ain't concerned about nobody but ourselves. We're going with the largest economy in the world, the strongest military power the world has ever seen, said, we're going to be small. We're going to be small. 21 million refugees living from pillar to post. Turkey has taken in 400,000 refugees from Syria. England has taken in over 1 million. Donald Trump says he wants to push ours down to only 50,000. We're going to be small. God bless America, nobody else. Right now they say Angela Merkel of Germany is the leader of the free world, because certainly our president is not trying to lead the free world. He's saying we're going to withdraw. We're going to be isolationists and protectionists. We're going to be the proverbial elephant that strains out a peanut. We're going to be the big dog with a small bark. We're going to be small. We're going to abandon the geopolitical issues. We're going to abandon the responsibility to leave the world. The Bible says, too much giveth, much is required. But we're saying, it's going to be about us. Just us. Sometimes nations choose to be small. Sometimes churches choose to be small. We're called as the children of God to give a witness of Jesus Christ and his love. And yet sometimes churches settle for the ritualistic things, creature comforts for the membership. Choose to be the frozen, chosen, engaging in private, inward navel gazing. We come to thank God for what he's done for us. The only thing we got for the local community is an alarm system. Keep them from breaking in. We drive in from our comfortable coves, drive back out past bombed out urban societies. don't even want the homeless or the hungry to come and sit on our pew because we don't want to smell their body odor. We can't even stand the scent of certain people. And our churches have, we give token lip service to commitment to the poor and the hungry, but we sure don't want to sit beside them. Sure don't want them staying in our building overnight. They might tear up our facility, which is not an instrument for ministry. It's a monument as to how much favor we have with God. We love giving our family and friends when they come from out of town a tour of the facilities, but don't you leave them people in here overnight. We choose to be small. We'll spend more money in a pastor's annual day banquet or a choir's annual day or the membership's men's and women's day than we're going to spend in food for the hungry or clothes to the naked or support for local people in the neighborhood. Spending all our money on services of self-celebration. Wonder why ain't nobody walking down the aisle, because Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. He didn't say lift up the pastor, the choir, and here we spend so much time giving flowers to each other that we don't give any recognition of the death, dying, suffering, and sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We chose to be small. It seems like we're living large. Crystal cathedrals and waterfalls. Armor bearers for the pastor who act like he can't carry his own briefcase or his own Bible. VIP parking spaces, manicured grounds, living large. We look better than the other churches because of the accoutrements, the appearances, and the ritual and the savvy of the service. And underneath it all, there's selfishness. If our name ain't in the program, we ain't even gonna serve. If I don't get Benny's back proportionate to my tithes and offering, I feel slighted, and suddenly I don't feel led. I'm gonna move my membership. Negro, you can go now. Ain't nobody here to capitulate to your temper tantrums, your Trumpism. Blowing up my phone over petty things that you ought to be ashamed that you got bothered about that in the first place. Sometimes churches are small. That's why you can have a crack house in a community. It changes life in the whole community as we know it. You can have a church on every corner and nothing changes because there's no power. No power to change and transform. Because the message is diluted. The song is become shallow. The ritual becomes empty, void of impact. Because it's the right thing for the wrong reason. Sometimes we as individuals choose to live small. When they make it all about us. I did a thing on Warren Buffett yesterday. Born in meager origins, has become one of the wealthiest men on the face of the planet. He's chosen to live big, not small. What a contrast to him and our current president, who says he's a billionaire, but we don't know. We haven't seen his tax returns. Never championed a cause for anybody unfortunate. Never led to fight to improve anyone else's life. Never fought for women or workers or minorities. Never championed any cause of condition for poor people anywhere or health concern for anybody. Didn't even give to his own charity. Used other people's money. Never did anything for anybody else. Just promoted himself and his gold-plated toilet seats on his Trump plane. Why would you put gold plating in something that still comes down to crap? And a lot of us live our lives like that. We gold plate stuff that at the end of the day is still crap. Amen. Compare that to Warren Buffett, who has vowed to give away 99.5% of all his wealth because somewhere along the way he learned that life is not lived in the abundance of things. It's not what you own, it's what owns you. Sometimes we choose, and we may not have that kind of money, but little people like you and I, everything is relative, relative to our own lives. We could do so much more, have so much more impact. Last night, I watched the NFL honors, and they gave out, there were two NFL Men of the Year. The highest award that they give out each year is not the MVP, it's the Man of the Year award, after Walter Payton. Sweetness, number 34, the Chicago Bears. The greatest team ever, the 1986 Chicago Bears. And but spent his life doing more off the field than he did on the field. Football just put him in a position to do more for others. And Eli Manning and Larry Fitzgerald, two co-winners of the NFL Man of the Year Award. And the thing about them, they come from very different backgrounds, but ended up at the same place. Eli Manning came from NFL royalty. He and his brother Peyton, the son of Archie Manning, NFL Hall of Fame quarterback, of the original quarterback for the New Orleans Saints in their franchise year of 1970. Grew up in privilege in a millionaire's home. Never had to get a free school lunch and, you know, a privileged, rich white man in America, and yet started visiting sick kids in the hospital and college, and it took, grabbed something in him. Kids' childhood should not be like this, filled with pain and suffering and sickness. And has dumped millions of dollars into medical research and poor kids in poor neighborhoods, and spends a couple of days a week, even during the season, just sitting in the hospital with poor kids, living very modestly of his own, so he can give more to other people. Larry Fitzgerald, one of two boys born to a single mother, single black mother, very different. White boy, NFL royalty, mother, family intact, and a black man, little two black boys and a single mother who just always served out of a Christ commitment. He's given time for the breast cancer research, and his own mother died of breast cancer. Now wants to make sure that as few other people lose their mother or their sister or their wife or their daughter to breast cancer. Giving time and money away somehow or another, they've learned to, where they could spend their time in fancy cars and do like the New York Giants, and before your playoff game, go down to Florida, take pictures with your shirt off and all that narcissism and hedonistic living. But instead they're in hospitals and in slums and in poor kids' schools. Living big, not living large, which is really to live small. It's not what you drive, it's what drives you. It's not what you have, it's what you do with it. Nobody begrudges you a nice car, a nice car, a nice house, and nice clothes, but in the abundance, in the balance of your life, do all the arrows point in or do they point out? Do you spend your life looking in the mirror or looking out the window pane? I can help somebody as I travel on. Cheer somebody with a word or song. Show somebody they're traveling wrong. Then my living shall not be in vain. I got to get out of here. But what God was saying through the prophet Isaiah is that God is calling you to a new thing. If you go make Israel great again, then here's what you got to do. You got to change the national priorities. Here's what you got to do, church. You got to change the church's priorities. Here's what you got to do, old man or woman of God. We want to talk about favor. You got to change your priorities. Ask yourself, what is the relationship between your life and all of its strength and benefits and privilege and investments in God? What is the relationship of your life to the advancement of the interests of people who are less fortunate than you? That's the ultimate test of your true devotion to God. If there's any currency backing your rituals, your sermon, your song, the appearances of devotion. Is it a blank check with nothing to back it? Or is there something in the bank, some currency behind all that you appear to do in God? He said, here's the acid test. Is there any real outpouring of your life on the behalf of the interests of those who are less fortunate than you? The only thing that motivates that is a sense that God was better to me than I've been to myself. Amen. And the only way to express that gratitude is to do all I can, while I can, as much as I can, because I can. And by this they'll know you're my disciples, that you love one another. Do you choose to live big? Or small?